goodness with care from our villages Arokya milk.
Hello people, welcome to episode 2 of Mahabharata with Anuja. Having got a taste of the Mahabharata, I'm so glad you're back for more. Today I'm going to tell you about Bhishma. He's one of the most loved characters in the Mahabharata. He's extremely inspiring and he's considered one of the pillars of the Mahabharata. Now this great man's destiny was governed by two curses and one boon. There are lots of curses and boons being flying around in these epics, and the course of his life was determined by these events, which I'm going to share with you. Now, in another age, a long time ago, there was a king named Mahabisha, and he belonged to the illustrious Ikshvaku line, and he had distinguished himself as a ruler and as a human being, and he was given a very, very rare honor. He was invited to the Sabha of Indra. Now it was, the highest honor they could give a mortal, and it was felt that Mahabisha deserved this. So he was seated at the Sabha of Indra with all the celestials and the sages gathered. There were lots of beautiful apsaras, and it so happened that goddess Ganga walked in that way. And this is also a typical scenario. There was a sudden gust of wind and her garments were in a state of disarray. All the gods averted their eyes out of respect to the mother goddess, but Mahabisha alone was smitten and he could not tear his gaze away. And Ganga also reciprocated his love. And when Brahma, the creator, witnessed this, he decreed that it was forbidden for a mortal and an immortal to fall in love. So he cursed the two of them. He said they would be reunited on earth, but there would be no happiness from their union. It would cause them both a lot of pain. So that was the curse. And later, Mahabisha was reborn as Shantanu, and Shantanu and Ganga were Bhishma's parents. Now, as I was saying, there was another curse involved as well, and this time it involved the Ashtavasus. These were demigods, and they were brothers, and the youngest was named Prabhasa. Now, Prabhasa had a wife named Varastri, and as they were all walking past sage Vasishta's hermitage, she desired his cow named Nandini, a very special cow born to sage Kashyapa and Surabhi. It had magical properties and it could give you the gift of immortality. It could fulfill all your desires. So a very special cow named Nandini. And Varastri asked her husband Prabhasa, "Would you mind getting that for me?" And he told her, "Why do you want to mess with Vasishta?" Vishwamitra also desired this cow and it led to a huge problem between these two. So let's not irritate the great sage Vasishta. She said, "I'm not asking for myself, I'm asking for a mortal friend of mine. She's going through a very difficult time and this cow could really help her." And Prabhasa, he should have, dissuaded his wife, but she succeeded in persuading him. So Prabhasa and the other Vasus, they stole this cow as well as her calf. And when Vasishta found out about this, he cursed them. He said they no longer deserve to be immortals. They would be cursed to live as mortals and suffer all the sorrows of a human existence. Now, when the Ashtavasus found out about this, they threw themselves at his feet. They begged for mercy. And Vasishta, being a very kind man, he said, "Okay, I will soften the curse for 7 of you. If you all can ask goddess Ganga to bear you and release you from birth and this cycle and all, you will be reinstated to your position as demigods." But Prabhasa was the chief schemer in this criminal act, so he alone will live a long life on earth, but it will be a very glorious one and people will never ever forget his story. And so it happened like that itself. The Ashtavasus went to Ganga and she also agreed. She said, "Okay, I will carry you all and I will release you from human existence." Now let's go back to Hastinapura, where King Shantanu was the king, and a very good king, a young king, and he happened to be taking a stroll on the banks of the Ganga. It was a very romantic setting, and suddenly he saw this extremely good-looking woman standing there, and he lost his heart to her at once. course, a repeat of that scene at the Sabha. And he went to her and he begged her to marry him at once. And he also asked, "Who are you? Tell me all about yourself." And this mysterious maiden said, "I will marry you. I will be a good wife to you. I will be the mother of your sons. But there are some conditions." And Shantanu said, "Whatever you want, whatever your heart desires, I will give it to you. I will even give you my life." Typical foolhardy statement of the ardent lover. And Ganga immediately told him, "You should never ask me about my past. You shouldn't ask who I am, where I come from. Please don't ask me any questions like that. And the second condition is, you should never utter a harsh word to me, no matter what I do." Now that's very ominous, but Shantanu said, of course, I accept. And he married this beautiful, mysterious woman. And initially, as always, love stories have great beginnings. They were very, very, very happy together. And when she conceived and was carrying his child, Shantanu's happiness just knew no bounds. But unfortunately for him, there was a lot of tears in store, because as soon as the baby was delivered, it was a beautiful, strong baby boy. The entire kingdom was celebrating, because heirs were highly desired in those days, even today, I guess. But Ganga would take this baby without a word to anyone. She will walk to the river where it was, you know, raging like that, and she'll just toss the baby in. And Shantanu, it's a measure of how much he loved her that he stopped himself from saying anything. But his heart broke when she did that. And yet he just couldn't dream of a life without her. And the two of them continued living together. And this was repeated on 7 separate occasions. 7 beautiful baby boys, and they were all tossed into the river. So she's basically a baby killer, considered the worst of crimes, and rightfully. And Shantanu started becoming angrier and angrier. And then 8th time, again she was pregnant. She seemed very excited and happy, you know. And Shantanu kept hoping that she would at least keep this child, let him have one heir. But when the child was born, Ganga was all smiles, but she carried the child to the river again. And this time Shantanu had enough. He went behind her, he spoke to her using the harshest language possible. He called her a monster. He said, "You're a fiend. What sort of a mother would do this to her newborn infant? You should die, not my sons." He spoke like this. And Ganga smiled very sadly at him. She said, "It was prophesized that our union would lead to a lot of pain. You've hurt me, I've hurt you. You've broken the terms of the condition. Very unfortunate. You just needed to be a little more patient. I could have lived with you, with our son. But a condition is a condition. I will have to leave you. But before I leave, I will tell you everything." And she told him about the Ashtavasus and the curse, and how they'd personally requested that she do this for them. So she was not to blame at all. And Shantanu was like very, very sorry about what he'd done. And then Ganga said, "I'm going to take my son. I'm going to name him Devrata. I will take this baby with me, and I will keep the child with me all the way during his childhood. Let him complete his training. I'll make sure he gets the best possible education to be a suitable ruler and a warrior. And don't worry, I will return him to you. After that, I will never see you again." Shantanu had no choice but to agree to all of this. And with a very, very heavy heart, he returned alone to his kingdom. And after that, he started keeping to himself. He would be very silent. He would do his duties. But he was living like a brahmachari. Meanwhile, Devrata and Devrata's childhood with his mother was a very magical time for both of them. Ganga took him across the 3 worlds, introduced him to all the gods. All the Devrishis used to educate him. And it is said that at Ganga's personal request, Parashurama himself agreed to train him as a warrior. And it was a very nice time for mother and son. But all too soon, he became one of the most skilled warriors in the world, and Ganga knew that it was time for him to fulfill his destiny. And so it happened that Shantanu happened to be walking along the banks of the river again, and he was lost in his memories. And he saw something very weird. He saw this godlike youth standing there, and he was shooting golden arrows straight into the river, which was in spate. And a beautiful golden bridge was formed. Not a bridge, a dam. A dam was formed, which just held back the raging waters of the river. And the river itself, it was known to be very violent and tempestuous, and yet there was so much affection in the way the river itself allowed itself to be held back by those golden arrows. And while Shantanu was watching this marvelous sight, Ganga appeared before him. She said, this is your son, Devrata. He's going to be the greatest ruler this world has seen. Take good care of my son. And she took her leave of both of them. Shantanu would have liked her to stay, of course, and even young Devrata was sorry to see her go, but he knew in his heart that she would always be there for him. And now father and son returned to the kingdom, and they became very close after a point. They would hang out all the time, and they got along very well together. And Shantanu decided to place him on the throne. And slowly he started retiring from his duties, started relaxing a bit and enjoying his old age. Now Bhishma, this at the time he was Devrata, he was quite an amazing ruler. He had fantastic potential and all the subjects were happy. But Shantanu, there was a twist in this tale. Shantanu did not expect to fall so violently in love again. But he went for a walk again on the banks of a river, the river Yamuna this time. And he noticed this gorgeous woman, and there was this intoxicating fragrance around her, and he just could not resist, and he went up to her and asked her about herself. She said her name was Satyavati, and she said, it's improper for you to talk to an unmarried woman like this. Please approach my father. Now a little bit about this Satyavati. It is said that she was born to a king named Uparicha Vasu, and an apsara who had been cursed to live as a fish was her mother. So she was born of this union, and she'd been left on the banks of the river, and a fisherman had found her. He was the chief of the fishermen, and he had raised this beautiful baby girl as his own. Now, when Shantanu went to this chief and spoke to this man in his very humble hut, he said, yes, I'm very, very honored that you want my daughter to be your queen. And 9 out of 10 men would have left it right there, but this guy was very, very cunning. He said, I have one condition though. See, my daughter is going to be your queen. She will bear you strong sons, and I feel that they should inherit the throne of Hastinapura. And Shantanu, of course, could not do this to Devrata and betray him. So with a very heavy heart, he refused. He went back, and then he started behaving like those people in romance novels. He started sighing a lot. He was pining away. He did not eat at all. And finally, Devrata approached his father. He said, tell me what's bothering you. Whatever it is, I'll take care of it. And he refused to tell him the truth. He just said, I worry. I have only one son. You're the best son a man can ask for. But what if anything happens to you? It will be horrible if our line should die out. I don't want that to happen. And Devrata immediately started questioning his father's closest men. And he spoke to the charioteer and he found out what had happened. And immediately he went to the fisher chief's house, and once again, he said, please give your daughter's hand in marriage to my father. And the same conditions were laid before him. And Devrata said, it's not at all an issue. I forfeit my right to the throne. It should have ended there. But again, this fisherman felt it wasn't good enough. He said, yes, yes, your reputation for nobility and generosity is well deserved. But your sons may not feel the same way as you. And I'm sure you'll have many sons, and if they are anything like you, they will be mighty warriors, and it will be a threat to my daughter's descendants, and I cannot allow that, can I? And immediately Devrata stood up. He stood up tall, and he said, right now, I swear that I will take no wives nor father any sons. I will practice the strictest celibacy. And immediately, such a young boy taking an oath like this, the heavens opened up, and flowers rained down on him, and the god said, this is Bhishma, one who has taken a terrible oath and one who's destined to keep it. And having done so, Bhishma very respectfully, he escorted his stepmom to his dad, and he started making preparations for the wedding. Shantanu was very, very grateful to his noble son, and he said, I give up all my ascetic merit to you. Death will come to you only when you desire it. And you know, so it was like Shantanu was married to Satyavati and things were all set. This concludes episode 2. In the next episode, I will tell you about a very, very famous woman who was spurned and scorned, and she managed the impossible task of gender reassignment in those days. Now, if you like this episode, please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel. And I love hearing from you, so do let me know what you think in the comments section. Thank you very much. Take care.
Goodness with care. From our villages, Arokya Milk.